COVID-19, how much of our diet could be a preventative measure? Could our first line of defense actually be what's on our plate? Well, new research is taking a look at just that, specifically what effect a plant-based diet may have on that. And so talking about this new research is someone who knows an awful lot about it. She is our director of clinical research at the Physicians Committee, Dr. Hana Kahleova. Dr. Kahleova, thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for having me, Chuck.
Somebody has said to me recently that the current pandemic is really a pandemic of health. It's forcing us to really take a good, long, hard look at some of the choices that we have been making day in and day out, including our diet. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, absolutely.
So what do we know then as far as the choices we've been making with our food and what effect that is having on the fact that, I mean, here in the United States, we're talking about 72 million cases as of this recording, and 873,000 people have lost their lives. So there's obviously a lot of cases there, a lot of unfortunate deaths. I guess really my question is, if we were taking a closer look at our health, would we be in a different situation here?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Let me share my screen and share a few slides with you because that's exactly the topic of our recently published paper. So, you know, when we're talking about plant-based diets and COVID-19, many people may think, well, wait a minute, like, does diet really have any effect on COVID? Isn't it the vaccinations that should help? And I need to say that we published the paper in the European Journal of Clinical Nutrition, and relying, for example, only on the vaccines doesn't seem to be plausible, because it seems to be our lifestyle and our overall health seems to be also influencing the effectiveness of the vaccines. For example, people who are overweight, who have more around their waist than what they should have, and then this is also associated with a lower efficiency of the vaccine and lower titers of the antibodies after the vaccine. In other words, lower protection after the vaccine. The same is true for smokers compared with non-smokers, lower levels of antibodies against COVID-19. And also for people who have high blood pressure or who have high cholesterol. Now, we kind of, that's in line with the fact that it's mostly people with comorbidities who are dying of COVID, people who have chronic diseases, who have diabetes and lung diseases, who are overweight and have cardiovascular disease. So these findings are just in line with this evidence. The question is, what kind of role does diet play specifically? This question has been researched by a few researchers. One of them was looking at the consumption of healthy plant-based foods, especially fruits and vegetables, in almost 600,000 people. And the study found out that people who were eating a lot of healthy plant-based foods, a lot of fruits and vegetables, had a 41% lower risk of severe COVID-19 and a 9% reduction of COVID-19 infection of any severity. Now, what about people who go completely vegan? There's a study in about 3,000 healthcare workers from six countries, including the US. And the study showed that people who report being on a plant-based diet have a 73% reduction in moderate to severe COVID-19. Now, we know that the blue zones are the areas on the Earth where people are the healthiest and live the longest on Earth. And we know that these are the areas where people tend to follow plant-based diets. So that inspired me to look into the eating habits, but also into the COVID-19 mortality in Okinawa, Japan, one of the blue zones. People in Okinawa eat pretty healthy. They eat predominantly a plant-based diet. The diet contains a lot of rice and soy foods and green leafy vegetables. And about half of the calories are coming from sweet potatoes. And the diet is super low in fat. Only 6% of calories are coming from fat. Now, in Okinawa, there are many people who live at least 100 years. So the prevalence of centenarians, that means people who live to at least 100 years, is almost double in Okinawa than in the rest of Japan. And Japan is the leader in longevity in the world. So this is really impressive. Now, when we look at COVID-19 mortality, when we compare Tokyo and Okinawa, which are roughly the same size and the same population areas, we see that in Okinawa, the COVID-19 mortality is 16 times lower compared with Tokyo. Now, this may partly be due to the lower density of population and less air pollution, but it's also thanks to the healthy lifestyle and the healthy diet in Okinawa. So it seems like we can learn some lessons from Okinawa and from the other studies that have been published, and we can be inspired how to be healthier amidst the pandemic. And let me unshare the slides.
So that's very interesting research, and it does kind of fall in line with what it was we were talking about at the beginning, as far as this being an opportunity for everyone to kind of take stock of where they are with their health. I want to talk to you about, you know, these rates of disease in Japan versus where we are here in the U.S. Okay, so if we just look at Japan as a whole, right, Tokyo, Okinawa, everywhere in Japan, and then we compare it to the prevalence of hypertension in the U.S., which right now I believe is 47% of all adults have hypertension. You've got 38% of all adults in the U.S. who have high cholesterol. So if those numbers were more in line with all of Japan, do you still think that the U.S. would have as many severe cases and as many deaths from COVID-19 as we have seen?
That's an excellent question. It seems from the evidence that we are collecting from around the world, it seems that the healthier the population, the lower the COVID-19 mortality. So, you know, as in the example in Okinawa and in Tokyo, in spite of the fact that the average age in Okinawa is higher than in the rest of Japan, people are healthier, have less cardiovascular disease, less chronic diseases in general, and have also lower COVID-19 mortality. So if we extrapolate, if our U.S. population got healthier, if we ate a healthy plant-based diet, and had, as a result, had less cardiovascular disease, less hypertension, less dyslipidemia, high cholesterol, and et cetera, then we may expect that the COVID-19 mortality would also be lower.
Here's where it gets tricky to me, though, is that then clearly you outlined the effects of a plant-based diet, but in this country, the keto diet is still super popular. So you're talking about high fat, lots of meat, generally not a lot of carbs. All right. And that really strips away the majority of fruits and vegetables and whole grains. But nonetheless, we're seeing people who do lose weight eating the keto diet. If somebody were subscribed to keto, not necessarily obese, though, what do you think that does in terms of their risk for COVID-19?
That's an excellent question. We know that people who are on a keto diet are advised to take a fiber supplement, a supplement with vitamins and minerals. And those would be crucial when we're talking about the immune function and, you know, our ability to fight off viruses and bacteria. So a natural way how to achieve that is, of course, consuming a lot of fruits and vegetables that are rich in the antioxidants and in fiber and minerals and vitamins. And those would be also higher in carbohydrates. Being on a higher carbohydrate diet that's also rich in antioxidants would be probably the best recipe for the immune system.
And one of the big comorbidities here is diabetes. Obviously, we've known that very early on in the pandemic, it became abundantly clear if you have diabetes, you're at a much higher risk of succumbing to COVID-19. That is something that you study very much in particular. And Dr. Kahleova, we do know the effectiveness of a plant-based diet in terms of preventing and even reversing diabetes, at the very least improving it almost virtually in every single instance. So is that particularly why you think that this is such an important diet here in terms of combating this pandemic here, because the prevalence of diabetes, just as we said, with high cholesterol and high blood pressure, I mean, the rate of diabetes in this country is also through the roof.
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly it. People with diabetes have their immune system suppressed. Their immune system is not functioning as well. The high blood sugar levels are suppressing the immune function. And so if we help people with diabetes, either completely reverse their diabetes or at least substantially reduce the high blood sugar, then it will automatically result in a better immune function.
All right. Yeah. Let's explore that for a second. I'm not sure that a lot of people get that. You just said that if you have diabetes, your immune system is pretty much automatically suppressed. So does that mean that if you have diabetes, you're automatically more susceptible to the common cold, all the way up to the flu? And then obviously you were just saying COVID-19 here.
Exactly. It's one of the conditions that increases your risk of having severe COVID-19 or even dying from COVID-19. I want to say it's about the high blood sugar levels that suppress the immune system. We're talking about diabetes that has not been treated or has been only poorly managed. That's representing a risk for all these negative outcomes. If your diabetes is well controlled, or if you decide to switch to a plant-based diet and completely reverse your diabetes, you can still turn things around.
Interesting. And one of the things that we have learned here in recent years, maybe not even so much recent years, I mean, if you go back decades, some of this research had already begun to emerge, is that when it comes to diabetes, everybody still thinks that sugar is the primary factor. Sugar in the diet is the primary factor. If you go with sugar-free, this or that, you're going to be okay. But what we do know, though, is that fat is really the primary driving factor for somebody acquiring type 2 diabetes. Plant-based diet, whole food plant-based diet, very much low in fat naturally. Is that then why this can be such an effective tool in combating this pandemic as well?
Absolutely. Right on point. I mean, the high fat diet also suppresses the immune system. So it's not only the sugar in your bloodstream, but it's also the fat that suppresses the immune function. The high-fat diet is pro-inflammatory. It just triggers the inflammatory response. We know that people who die from COVID eventually don't die from the virus itself, but it's from the inflammation that gets out of control. you know, avoiding the inflammation, suppressing the inflammation by all means, you know, is a good idea. And plant-based diets have been shown to be anti-inflammatory compared with Western diets.
And obviously also with a plant-based diet, you are getting a very nutrient-dense diet, right? So it's lower in fat, but it is higher in virtually every other nutrient across the board. So, you know, I would think that all of those healthy vitamins, healthy minerals, healthy nutrients, they also work to boost up that immune system and in turn can really help protect you as this pandemic continues.
Yeah, I completely agree.
Yeah. All right. Well, Dr. Kahleova, this is definitely something to keep an eye on. I'm curious, how has this research been received by your colleagues in the medical world?
Yeah, that's a really great question and an important one too. Although many healthcare professionals are kind of hesitant to receive any news about the importance of diet. Now, you know, the studies are pretty clear that diet plays a major role in even in this COVID-19 pandemic. And so even healthcare professionals are more aware of the role of diet in this. And so I'm grateful that we have the opportunity to share the research with others. And I'd like to encourage the listeners to do the same.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And the studies that you cited today, I mean, it was great that medical workers were among them. But then closer to home, you worked with a number of people at Sibley Hospital, which is based in Washington, D.C., had them transition to a plant-based diet during the pandemic. And they also saw great improvements to their health. I would think that that would also go to really kind of opening some eyes and getting some others, your colleagues in the medical world, to really kind of take a closer look at this as well.
Absolutely. A personal experience always expands, you know, your ability to receive the news.
Dr. Kahleova, appreciate your time.
Thank you so much, Chuck.
If your health IQ is a couple of points higher than it was a few minutes ago, go ahead and like this video or subscribe to the YouTube channel. And to take it even higher, head over to Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your favorite shows. Look for The Exam Room by the Physicians Committee. Hit the subscribe button there as well and help to make your world a healthier place.